Shmura, Perek Shishi, page 31. In Yirtzeh Hashem, we're going to complete this Perek Shishi, the sixth Perek. Soon we're going to read the Mishnah, the disputation, if the offspring of Behemat Treifa, the animal that it's already under the category of Treifa, it's also considered as Treifa and it make it disqualified from being a Korban, or the offspring is permissible, but the Gemara said that everyone agreed when it's come to Efroach Shebakami Beitza, that the offspring that came out of the egg, that out of Tanegolet Treifa, so there it's not an issue. But later on, we're going, time allows, the Machloket and basically the view of the Remain Shulchan Aruch and Rav Mordechai Yaffe in the Levush, how you treated a situation, even it's a rare, but situations like that. So let's start with the statement from the Mishnah, page 31, the top of the page. Rabbi Eliezer Omer Vlad Treifa. They said that Rabbi Eliezer hold that the offspring of Treifa is prohibited to be offered on the altar, and the Chachamim, the sages, permit it. So the Gemara said, Leman Damar Treifa. Some said Yoledet, some said Ena Yalda, Mashkachala Kegon Shnitrefa Ulvasof Ivra. So the situation is that it becomes Treifa and later on becomes pregnant. The Gemara expanded on that and said, Ubehapligid Rabbi Eliezer Savar, Zeveze Gorem Asur, Verabanan Savri, Zeveze Gorem Mutar. So Rabbi Eliezer holds that both permitted factor and that prohibited factor caused the certain situation, which is the resulting is that they prohibited, and therefore the Treifa is prohibited to have yes, an offering. The sages swore that the principle is ze veze gorem mutar, the prohibited and permitted factors is permitted, so offspring is permitted like its father. Lemand amar treifa ena chaya, mashkach ala kigon shi'ibra ulbasof nitreifa. So according to one who says that treifa cannot survive, which is cannot give birth, so you find the dispute in a case where the animal first became pregnant and then became treifa. Ubehapligid Rabbi Eliezer savar ubar rechimoru, v'rablan savri ubar lavi rechimoru. So Rabbi Eliezer said that the fetus is considered the thigh of its mother, and therefore, just as its mother is prohibited to be offered on the altar as a treifa, the same applies to its offspring. Rabbanan Sabre Ubar Lavi Rechimo. They just hold that the fetus is not considered the thigh of its mother, and consequently, there is no reason to prohibit it to be offered on the altar. אמר רב הונא, מודים רחמים לרבי אליעזר באפרוח ביצת טריפה שאסור. The sages agree to concede to Rabbi Eliezer in a case of a chick that emerges from the egg of treifa dove. My time, the reason for that. עד כאן לא פליג על רבי אליעזר אלא בבלד בהמה. Thank you. Rabbi Eliezer hold only in regards to offspring of an animal which grows from its own space. The Ma'avira Karavya, which is even if it's its mother womb, it develops an independent entity. Aval Betzat Treifa, but egg of Treifa, hen, Migufa Letarnegolta Karavya, it grows from the body of the hen. Afilu Rabbanan Modiu, even the sages agree that the chick which emerges from the egg may not be offered on the altar. Amar Lerava Leravuna Tanya Demsayalach, I have a support, a bride that support your view. Melot arvad rima ba'im adam chai. When you have a full ladder of worms that come out of a living person, which can be many, many situations. So they said, Rabbi Eliezer metameh v'chamim metameh. Rabbi Eliezer said it is ritually impure. The sages said that it is okay, it's pure. Ad kan lo plig rabbanan labela berima. The Prisha Malman, so the sages disagree only when it's come to worm, which is merely a secretion. אבל ביצה מגופת תרנגולת היא, but egg, that as we said, it is parts of the hen's body. אפילו רבנן מודו, even the sages concede that the, in the case of treifa, the chick that emerges from the egg is prohibited to the altar. אמר לי, אביי, עד רבם, איתך במסתברה. אביי said just the opposite. עד כאן לא פליג רבי אליעזר עלי עוד רבנן לברימה. Rabbi Eliezer disputed on the sages up to this point only when it's regards to worm, because he hold that the worms are considered part of the persons even if they are emerges from him while he was still alive. דיקר אדם מחיים רימה דכתיב ותקוות אנוש רימה ובן אדם תולעה. That's a pasuk in Eov, chapter 25. אבל גבי בצד אימד גדלה לחימס רכה. When the egg, when it's grow, and it emerges from the egg, it does not, have the egg rot, which is, the rot is considered merely dust, and is no longer attributed to the hand that laid it. וחייס רפה אפר באלמה הוא, אפילו רבי אליעזר מודה, even רבי אליעזר concede that the chick that emerges from its egg is permitted to be offered. ועוד, and furthermore, תניה בהדיה, מודה רבי אליעזר רחמים בפרוח בצד רפה שמותר, אמר לי, סורבה סטו אביי, היא תניה תניה. If the bride is taught, it is taught, and I cannot take the issue with it. רבי חנינא בן אנטיגנוס אומר כשרה. מהי תמה? So he said that the kosher animal that suckle from a treifa is disqualified from being offered on the altar. The reason for that, אילמה דמיפת ממינה, if you tell me that it's fattened from the treifa's animal, אלא מעתה אכלן כשני עבודה זרה, אכלן עמד אסירף. This is the case when we learned it earlier. If its owner fed the vatches of idolatry, so too should one say that it's prohibited. Feeding an animal vatches of idolatry rendered prohibited only if the animal has been set aside for idolatry, for avodah zarah. But a regular animal is not prohibited by this action. אלא תני רבי חנינא תריתא כמיד רבי יוחנן. כגון שהניקה חלב רותח משחרית לשחרית. The cases that suckle from a treifa worm, a fresh milk every morning. So, הואיל ויכולה לעמוד עליה מעת לעת, since the kosher animal can maintain its existence based upon the suckling from 24 hours period until the next suckling. So, it survives only because of the treifa animal. So, as a result, the kosher animal is prohibited to be offered on the altar. כל הקודשים שנעשו טריפה הם פודין. The Mishnah further teaches us that all offering animal that became treifa, one may redeem them and render the non-sacred, and the consumption is prohibited, and one does not redeem sacrificial animal to feed them to dogs. מנהל מילה תנו רבנן תסבח, the פסוק said in Devarim chapter 12. So תסבח, you may slaughter. ולא גיזה, but not shear the wool. ואכלת, you shall eat, and eat. ולא לכלביך, it's not, may not give it to your dog to eat. בשר ולא חלב. Obviously flesh, it's not milk. מכאן שהם פודים את הקודשים לאכילן לכלבים. From here it arrives that it is prohibited to take the sacrificial offering. The one does not redeem the sacrificial offering to feed them to dogs. איקד אגד מתסבח ואכלת, פסוק said, you may slaughter and eat. אין לך ביתר אלא בשעת זביחה ואילך. The only permission is from them only with the time of slaughter and onward, which is those benefits that come after slaughter, such as the consumption of its flesh, are permitted. However, one may not derive benefit from their slaughtering or the milk. אלא בשעת זביחה ואילך, כסבר אין פודים לקודשים לאכילן הכלבים, he hold, that one may not redeem sacrificial animal to feed them to dogs, as this occurred after the slaughter. Hadran alach kol ha'asurim. Just a small comment before we go to the next perek. There is a Rashi here. Dibur ha'matchil ikra de'amrei tizbach ve'achalt basar en lecha bo heter achila lemishat zvicha. Rashi here used the word klomar lo tehatne mechayim aval klavecha lachar mitahu אפילו בלא זביחה, שפיר דה המיופודין, את הקודשים לאכילן כלבים. So, obviously, we not have the time, but those who have time, there is a very important point that Rashi tried to to explain. Anyway, the next perek, Mitzvah Shem, perek Shvi'i, Yesh Bekodshei Mizbeach. Short introduction, there is Gemara in Baba Kama, page 76. The Gemara explained to us, we learn it, the difference between Kodshei Bedek Habayit and Kodshei Mizbeach. The Gemara explained there, Baba Kama 76, in Tosfot there, that there is a concept we call Mamon Hekdesh, the money that belongs to the Hekdesh, that's called Shebedek Habayit, the sanctification that something belongs to the temple treasury. And there is the other one, which is Kodshei Mizbeach. Tosfot explained that that's called Mamon Be'alim, that's the owner estate. So here they speak about stringencies. Yesh Bekodshei Mizbeach Shein Bekodshei Bedek Habayit. Yesh Bekodshei Bedek Habayit Shein Bekodshei Mizbeach. Meaning there are those elements that apply to animals consecrated for the altar that do not apply to items consecrated for temple maintenance, and vice versa. There are elements that apply to items consecrated for temple maintenance that do not apply to animal consecrated for the altar. There is a expansion on that in the both in Birkat Shmuel and Baba Kama 34. You see it also expansion on that in the Or Sameach, Hilchot Erkin, chapter 5. But the key is that that we have two categories of chumrot and can apply solely to one of them. Now the Mishnah expand on that, elaborates, and they said those chumrot, those stringency that applies to Kodshei Mizbeach, those animals that consecrated for the altar. Shekodshei Mizbeach osin tmura, vekodshei Beit HaKabayit en osin tmura. So it's a few girsaot. We go by the way that Rashi explained, and as we said, based on Gemara in Bava Kama 76, there is a different girsaot, the Shittim Kubetzet and others that go differently. But anyway, so the one element that that exclusive to animal consecrated for the altar is that the animal consecrated for the altar render an animal exchanged for them a substitute, and that's the concept in this Masechet. And the item that consecrated for the temple maintenance that do not render the animal exchanged for them a substitute. Furthermore, Kodshei Mizbeach Chayvim Alav Mishum Pigul Notar Vetameh. The animal that consecrated for the altar with the intention to eat it beyond its designated time, or if it ate the offering after the designated time, or if he ate the offering while ritually tameh, ritually impure, he is liable to receive karet for eating it due to violation of the prohibition of pigul. We explained many times the pigul and the notar, leftover, and vetameh, and eating while ritually impure, respectfully. So that basically we go by the way that the Shita Mekubetzet explained, and we explained it in the past that pigul is eating a korban, a consecrated animal, while a person did it after the proper time, la'achar zmanan. Notar, which is a consecrated meat, besar kodashim, that they ate it after the proper time. So someone who eat pigul, even during the time, but it was a pigul, or notar, left over intentionally, b'mezid, so he received karet. Tameh, that's the concept here is someone who's eating consecrated item while he's in a state of ritual impurity, and that person that ate intentionally kodashim, he received karet. So that's the chiddush here in the Mishnah, that's applied kodesh beit HaKabayit, but not the kodesh mizbeach, applied to consecrated animals for the altar, but not animal that consecrated for the purpose of temple maintenance. the base on that is the Vayikra, the Leviticus 22, verse 3. And you see there also in the Leviticus 7, verses 20 and 21. The Chidushei Agriz expand a lot on this sugya, and again, those who have time can see more on that, both Chidushei Agriz and Rambam, Hilchot Arachin v'Charamin, chapter 7. Page 31b. Vladan v'chalavan asur l'achar pidyonan. If the animal consecrated for the altar became pregnant and then became blemish and gave birth after redemption, their offspring and the milk are forbidden after their redemption. And there is a big ma'alach in Magna Mefarshim. If the whole idea is based on the rabbinic or based on the Torah, but simply speaking, is based on the Torah, the Gemara in Bchorot 15b, expand on that. Vashuchatan bachutz, if someone slaughtered them outside of Beit HaMikdash while they're not redeemed, chayav, he is liable to receive karet, that's kodashim bachutz. En notnim mehen le'umanin, bischaran, you don't, the temple treasurer does not give compensation to craftsmen from money designated for purchasing animals consecrated for the altar. And in all these instances, mashen ken bekodshei bedek habayit. So it's not applied in regard to money consecrated for the temple maintenance. Verses, yesh bekodshei bedek habayit. So there are chumrot, there are elements to apply to item consecrated for the temple maintenance that do not apply to animals consecrated for the altar. Shestam hekdeshod levedek habayit, that the unspecified consecrations are designated for the temple maintenance. There is a shita mekubetzet and Rashi that hold that there's a disputation among the Tanaim on this. Hekdesh bedek habayit chal al hakol. So the consecration for the temple maintenance applies to take effect on all items, and one is liable to bring a guilt offering and pay an additional payment of one-fifth for misuse of consecrated property, not only for the item themselves. הקדש בלי הבית חי לכל ומועלים בגידוליהם ואין בהם מנעה לבעלים. It's also for their produce, which is milk of a consecrated animal or eggs of a consecrated chicken. And there is no benefit for the owner from items consecrated for temple maintenance, in contrast to some animals consecrated for the altar, which is a peace offering for which there is a benefit for the owner. So the Mishnah teaches in a very general term that consecrated item for the altar, they can have the tmurah, they can have the concept of substitute. So the Gemara questions the statement of the Mishnah that item consecrated for the altar renders the animal exchange for its substitute. Uchlalahu dechol kodshei mizbeach osim tmurah. And that's really an established rule that anything consecrated for the altar renders the animal exchange for its substitute. Here is an example. V'arei ofot, the bird that consecrated for korban, for offering. The kodshei mizbeachem, that is consecrated for the altar. And nevertheless, utnan, we learn earlier in the Mishnah on page 13, amnachot v'ha'ofot ein osim tmura. Meal offering and bird offering do not render an animal exchange for them a substitute. So the Gemara answered and said, ki katane, when the Mishnah teaches this principle, abehema, So they start only with regard to animal offering. So the more ask, Varev Lad, could Shem Yisbeachu, the offspring of an animal consecrated for the altar, which is consecrated for the altar, and yet we learn the Mishnah in the Tmura, page 12, Utnan Ena Valad, Use Tmura, the offspring of an animal consecrated for the altar, does not render an animal exchanged for it a substitute. So the Gemara explain, Kamani, according to him whom this Mishnah applies, Rabbi Yehuda Ihi, that's the view of Rabbi Yehuda, the Amar Valad Ose Tmura, unlike Tanakama, he said that the offspring of an animal consecrated for the altar renders an animal exchanged for it a substitute. So Gemara ask, Vahari Tmura Atzma, that the substitute itself, which is consecrated for the altar, the kudshei mizbeach utnan en tmura osa tmura, which means that animal that hitkadsha ledei tmura, that consecrated by designated as a substitute animal, and another person come and substitute it with another animal, the last one that was a substitute will not consecrated as a tmura, ain tmura osa tmura, a substitute does not render an animal exchange for it a substitute. So Gemara said, ki katane ha'ikar zivcha. We teach us basically as a principle to the animal initially consecrated as an offering, not an animal consecrated by extension, which is a substitute. The Shita Mekubetzet expand on that. Anyway, so Dao the Gemara said, Hashta de Atit Leachin, now that you give this point, this qualification of the established principle, so you don't need to resolve the difficulty from the case of offspring of consecrated animal by saying that the its Mishnah is follow the view of Rabbi Yehuda. Rather, you may even say that the Mishnah is follow the view of the sages. Hashta de Atit Leachin Afilu Tema Rabbanan. You said that it's the taught in Mishnah, it was taught only with regard to principle, the principal offering. As we said, that the Shita Mekubetzet expanded on that a lot. The Mishnah continues and says, Yesh bekodshei mizbeach, ve'en notnim mehem le'umanim. We don't give it to craftsmen, compensation for that money that designated for purchasing animals consecrated for the altar. So the Gemara derived from that hakodshe bedekabayit notnim, but the animals that consecrated for the temple maintenance we're giving to a craftsman. So how do you derive this halacha? Mar Rabbi Abaudah Mar Krav ve'asu li mikdash. We said in Shemot chapter 25, verse 8, they shall consecrate it for me, make for me a sanctuary, and I will dwell upon them. So the verse indicates that the tabernacle can be consecrated from the which is mine, which is consecrated property. Misheli, so consequently, consecrated property may not be used to pay the wages of a craftsman for work performed in the service of the tabernacles. Yesh bekod shebedek habayit, there are chumrot, there are elements of stringencies that applies to consecrated item for temple maintenance that do not apply to animals consecrated for the altar. So the Gemara said, Amar mar, stam ekdeshot lebedek habayit v'chal al hakol. If you have some unspecified consecrated or designated for temple maintenance, and consecration for temple maintenance take effects on all items. So they said, who is the one who teaches Mantana, that unspecified animal that one consecrated is go for temple maintenance, even if it's befitting for the Mizbeach, for the altar? Amar Rabbi Chiya bar Abba, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Delo k'Rabbi Yoshua ditnan. That's a Mishnah in Shkalim, chapter 4, Mishnah 7. Hamakdish nechasav. If someone consecrated his estate without specifying for what, if it's for the altar, if it's the temple maintenance, it was an animal there that's suitable for offering upon the altar, male or female, what will be done with it? So they said, zcharim u'nekevot, Rabbi Eliezer omer, zcharim imachul tzorchei alot, male should be sold for the purpose of a burn offering. when the kivot and the female animals that not befitting for burn offering, yimachu letzochei shlamim shall be sold that for the purpose of a peace offering, because peace offering can come for both, for male or female animals. The Torah said it in Vayikra chapter 3. Ud mehem, the money that comes out of that redemption of the animals, regardless if it's a male or female animal, yipluim shar nechasim lebede kapayit, so be together with, allocated with the rest of the property for the temple maintenance. Rabbi Yoshua omer zcharim hen atzma mikarvu olot. Rabbi Yoshua said that the males are not sold, rather they themselves should be sacrificed as a burn offering. Unkevot yimachu lezorchei shlamim, and a female for the purse offering. Viavi bidmehen olot, and he takes that money of redemption, and you get burn offering. The assumption is that he intends to have it for the altar. And ushar nechasim yiplu lebede kapayit, the rest of the estate will go for the temple maintenance. So you see this, Rabbi Yeshua maintains that unspecified, consecrated are not necessarily designated for temple maintenance. Upliga. So that view of Rabbi Eliezer disputed Rav Avada bar Rava. Ufliga de Rav Avada bar Rava, damar Rav Avada bar Rava, amar Rav, be'eder shekulo zcharim, if you have a herd that was entirely male, afilu Rabbi Eliezer modeh, de lo shavik inish kol shem mizbeach, magdish lebede kapayit. The person should not take something that consecrated for the altar and instead consecrated for temple maintenance, even if the owner consecrated them, those animals without specification, it is presumed that they consecrated to them for sacrifice upon the altar. Lo nechelku ala ba'eder sheyesh bo mechtzaz charim mechtzan kevod. The disputation is when you have a herd that has half male and half female. Rabbi Eliezer sabar en cholek al nidro. Rabbi Eliezer said that the estate, a single vow that must be fulfilled in different ways, so that one does not divide his vow. Since the female are not consecrated as a burn offering must be male, it must be that the male are also not consecrated as a burn offering. Rabbi Yoshua Savar, Adam Cholek et Nidro. He said that the person does divide his vow. So therefore, we remain the same assumption that we said that the person will not leave the Kodesh Mizbeach, the consecrated for the altar and consecrated for the temple maintenance, and he intend to consecrate the animal for the altar. So even there are other estate that he consecrated for temple maintenance. Udmehem, some said Tnan, that's the Shitam Kubetzet. So the Mishnah in Shkalim said that the money from their sale is allocated for with the rest of the property for temple maintenance. So the Gemara asks, "Bishlam al lishna batra haynu dektane im shan nechasim lebedek habayit, el lishna kama litne yiplu lebedek habayit." So they said, "Tanina meachi." Some said, "Tnei hachi udmehen iplu lebedek habayit." The money from the sale is allocated for temple maintenance. The Mishnah said, "Hekdesh bedek habayit chal al hakol." The consecrated for temple maintenance take effect on all items. You see here a clear emphasis that indicates that it takes effect even on the item that one might otherwise have thought are not consecrated. So the Gemara asks, La tuye mai, what is hakol come to teach us? What's the emphasis? Maravin le tuye shfuye veniva. So they add a shaving and falling leaves. So that's also consecrated in Kedushat Habayit, in the consecrated for temple maintenance. The Mishnah said, Umo'alin begidulehen, that one is liable for misuse of items consecrated for temple maintenance and for their byproducts, but one is not liable for misuse of byproducts of animal consecrated for the altar. So now the Gemara elaborates When the Mishnah states that one is not liable for misuse of byproducts of animal consecrated for the altar, this served to add what? La tuyei maya marav papa la tuyei b'kedushat mizbeach chalev hamukdashin u'beitzei torin. That's Mishnah in Me'ilah, chapter 12, page 12b. So that's that's excluded the consecrated item for the altar, such as milk for from sacrificial animals and eggs of pigeons. K'detanya, chelev mukdashim ubeitzei torin lo nehenin velo moilin. So they said in the Braita that milk of sacrificial animals and eggs of pigeons, one may not derive benefit from them lechatchila, but if one derived benefit from them, he is not liable for misuse. B'me dvarim omrim b'kodshem mizbeach. Egg or milk that those animals or birds that consecrated for the altar. Aval b'kodshei bedek habayit, but when it's come to consecrated for the temple maintenance, hikdish tarnegolet mo'alin bebeitzata. If one consecrated a chicken for temple maintenance, he's liable for misusing its eggs. Or if one consecrated a female donkey for temple maintenance, chamura mo'alin b'chalava. So one is liable for misusing its milk, because the essence, the yesod of kedushat bedek habayit is kedushat damim. So therefore the eggs, the milk and the eggs are fitting to be sold and use the money of their redemption from temple maintenance. So therefore they have halot hekdesh on this, and therefore the law of Me'ilah, the misuse, applies to them as well. That's the Rashi Me'ilah. And the Gemara concluded in saying, afilu leman d'amar mo'alim bekedushei mizbeach, and even according to one who holds that one is liable for misusing byproducts of animal consecrated for the altar, hanemilei, that applies kidulin dachazu lamizbeach. So it's applied by to byproducts that are fit for the altar. Aval gidulin de lochazu lamizbeach. But with regards to byproducts that are not fit for the altar, which is eggs and milks, ein mo'alin b'hem, one is not liable for misusing them. So Rashi expanded on that. Tosfot challenged that. The Minchat Chinuch in Simanim, chapters 30 and 31, expand on this sugiya. I would like just to conclude with something we talk at the early stage of the Hagdama. We discussed just a little bit about the machloket, if Vlad Behema, treifa, if the offspring of an animal that was treifa, excuse me, is also considering it treifa, and it's a pasul, it's unfitting for being an offering, or it's okay. So according to the Gemara, we said that everyone agrees that we can eat the efroach shebakami beitza, that the chick that come out of the eggs, that comes out of it, tarnegolet treifa, because the efroach, it's apply only after the animal masricha, after the animal and bring it out. So therefore, stage, they have pkiata isu. It's no longer have that prohibition, because it's considering as stam afar, just a little dust. So the you see it also in Shulchan Aruch, but the Rema brings in Agaha that the yesh omrim lak, yesh lo noagim lakel baze. There are those who are very scrupulous, very careful. Ulchatchila yesh liyizher lo lechol efroach kaze. One should be careful not to eat this type come out of tarnegolet treifa. the source of the Rama, it's the Sefer Isur Ve'eter Ha'aroch. But the Rama himself in Darkei Moshe said that he doesn't know what's the reason for that, because the Gemara said clearly that he's a muta, but he brings this Chumra as a Hagar LaShulchan Aruch, the Rama. But one of the students of the Rama, Rav Mordechai Yaffe, in his book Levush, he took out that comment of his teacher. Usually brings his view, but most probably he felt that it's not right to be machmir in this, something that the Gemara said clearly that is muta. And following the Levush, most of the Achronim said it's muta. But we have to emphasize that this applies specifically to the Efroach that came out of Beitza, of eggs. But if the Beitza Tzma, the eggs himself, came out of Tarnegolet Reifa, so therefore everyone agrees that is also Be'achila Lechule Alma, by everyone.